Actually, you know what I got that's a really interesting? I wonder if anybody in the Mumble Room has any experience with any of this crap. I got one of these Logitech Harmony Hub. My dad got this for me for my birthday last week. And so it's a puck-looking thing, and it has basically like 1,000 IR blasters in it that shoot off in every direction. And you then pair it with a whatever. You could just use the app, or you pair it with like an Alexa, or you can actually control it from a Roku, or lots of things. And it allows you to voice control your television and your DVR and your internet media set-top box, whatever it might be. And I don't know how much it is because, like I said, it was a gift. But I just got it, and now I'm wondering how the hell I set it up. Here, they got a little thing on it.
Yeah. One-touch control, because everyone wants touchscreen. Who wants to use touchscreen controls for their...
I do.
Hello, Wes!
What, we got to get, like, oily fingerprints on the screen. Come on.
Like, I want to be able to control my... I want to control my TV with physical buttons. Like, I want to be able to feel them. Or my voice. I would take that. If it could, if the thing had good enough mics to pick me up. So this would use the Alexa to, so the Alexa would be the front end of the Harmony Hub. I just got the Harmony Hub as a gift.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. And it does basically, it is like this huge IR blaster. And so you kind of put it in the middle of your entertainment system and it blasts out all directions to control your different devices and stuff.
And it comes with a bunch of apps that you can use.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know when someone doesn't have an Amazon Echo or an Echo Dot is when they're quite confident in saying Alexa out loud.
Oh, you're right. No, I've got one in this room. I should know better. I'm working on it. I really am. I'm trying to say Echo. I'm also trying not to say okay Googs. You know, I'm trying and also hey S word. I'm trying not to do any of that stuff because
I find myself saying it like prudes from the past say the word sex like under their breath. Like,
yeah, Alexa. Yeah, yeah. That's what I do too. Usually, really quietly. Yeah.
My daughter's been figuring out where she can use the word so that it doesn't trigger.
Yeah, my son's
and
been...
And she's figured out if it's mid-sentence, she can get away with it, but it can't be at the beginning or the end of the sentence.
Yeah.
And when she's talking about it, she calls it Lexi.
Oh, that's good. I have noticed that my kids have adopted the A word. They say the A word, which is funny because that could mean other things, but to them it means... You know what I mean? It means.
Wouldn't it be cool if Amazon had thought of this beforehand and it called it a different name than Alexa?
Well, I mean, how common
no,
is that
because
name?
I had the most fun with this though because I successfully trolled a friend by giving him an Echo Dot, and his wife's name is Alexa.
No. No.
That's awesome. Wow.
No. What are the chances? I didn't think it was that common of a name.
No, neither did I. But as soon as I tweeted, I was like, hang on a minute. And he's also called Martin. I was like, Martin's wife is called Alexa. This is too much fun.
That's incredible. This is Linux Unplugged, episode 182 for January 31st, 2017. Welcome to Linux Unplugged, your weekly Linux talk show that's so awash in new Linux hardware, we're not sure where to start the reviews first. My name is Chris.
My name is Wes.
Hello there, Wes.
Hello.
It's a nice piece of shiny hardware you have sitting next to you we'll be talking about later on in the show
it's
today.
It's very nice.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes, we got a good show today later on, too. The part that I'm looking forward to the most, we're going to hack Popey's server live on the show. We're going to hack Popey, right? Live on the show. We're going to do that. And, of course, we'll do some open source project updates, chat a little new hardware. There's some big, big things on the horizon that I'm working on that I want to talk to you guys about, pick your brains about a little bit. Ryan's here from System 76 to make us drool over one of their new rigs.
Nice.
I know.
I'm drooling already. Whoops.
You know what, Wes? It's good to have you back. I missed you last week.
It is a pleasure to be back. I was sad to be gone.
You always get me. So yeah, we got a whole bunch of good stuff to go over. Plus, we got the hack and we got the new hardware. But bigger than all of that, Wes is back and he brought us an oaked maple hard cider. I don't even know what that is.
I'm not. Yep.
I think it's apples, right? It's got to be. But it's so delicious. It's a semi-sweet Seattle-based cider he brought us.
Oak chips and
back sweetened with pure Vermont maple syrup.
Okay. Interesting.
Shut up. It really is maple syrup? So it's a Vermont maple syrup beer that we're drinking from Seattle. I'll take it. All right. Well, we have many things to get into this week here on Your Linux Unplugged. So let's bring in our virtual lug. Time appropriate greetings, Mama Room.
Hello.
Greetings.
Hello.
Oh, man.
Hello,
that's
guys.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's good every time. It gets it every single time. Yeah, I would imagine you can have cider made out of other things, Sweetland. Mm-hmm. You can have, in fact, hard cherry cider is a real thing. It is real.
Oh, yeah.
I
just used apple cider.
Yeah, apple cider, I think, is probably the most. Yeah, pear cider, that's another one. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but that's not what we're talking about today.
Nope. We got some Linux things first.
We do. I've had a very interesting week in Linux. I've been going on and on and on about this building this bulletproof Linux workstation for me. Just one or two of my systems that I want to last for like 5 years. I'm trying not to talk about it too much because I know not everybody cares, but it's really been what I've been living for almost 2-3 weeks now, actually. Because it started when I had an Arch crash.
Ooh.
Yeah, right in the middle of a project. And then it just sort of got me down this path of, well, how would I build a system if I never wanted it to crash again? And there's so many different ways to split this up. I kind of begun to land on sort of a Solus or Arch with Budgie desktop combo. And then that crazy guy, Ikey, right after last week's show. Like, we get off the air with Ikey last week.
Just chatting.
And he runs off and announces to the entire world that he's switching the Budgie desktop over to Qt. Which I think is probably a good long-term move. Because, you know, there's a lot of things they've had to do to make it sort of pretend like GNOME over the years.
Right.
And there's a lot of crazy folks out there that are rewriting their desktops over to Qt these days.
There seems to be a trend.
Yeah. Well, and I think there's a reason for it. It's not just because it's a trend, but also because there's some real technical merits to Qt versus GTK when you're building something that's not GNOME and GNOME applications.
Right.
And I thought that was all great and good, except for the fact that it leaves me all of a sudden with the Budgie desktop about to go through this large transition.
A lot more change than you maybe otherwise would have expected.
Right, even change for the better, you might argue.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that they will only release it when they feel like it's ready for the end users. But even still, like, I'm building a 5-year workstation here, right? And so really it was Ikey's fault. He got me thinking. Ikey and also producer Michael. I blame producer Michael also quite a bit for this too. It really, really got me seriously thinking about the Plasma desktop.
Mm.
And so I installed Plasma 5.8 a week and change ago.
On top of Solus?
On top of Arch.
Arch, okay.
Yeah, I figured I fixed my core Arch issue, which was a stupid infidelity font issue. And I got the Plasma desktop set up. And it has been 5.8 has been, I didn't mean to turn this into a quick Plasma review, but I have never used a more stable, rock solid version of the Plasma desktop. I mean, it, every day, the week it's been installed on my system, and it's been a little more than a week, every day for that entire time has met the, as my butt is entering the cushion of the chair, as it's grabbing my butt, my keys are already being flicked by my fingers, and I'm already working, and every time it's ready to go. It's ready to go. I don't have to futz with nothing. Nothing gets in my way. I immediately start working the moment I walk. And I've set everything up, dude. I've even got an Echo in there so that way, as I'm walking into the room, I can activate all the devices I want. It's like this.
There's
enter the door,
latency.
I spin around, I sit down, and I start working. And I issue
the spinning's really important.
It
a
is.
Lot of spinning.
You got to twirl.
Yeah.
You got to take time to twirl and skip. And then I issue an Echo command. It powers up all my devices. And as I'm sitting down at my keyboard, I'm working. There is zero friction to getting to work. And that's kind of necessary when, like, sometimes I'm like running into the studio. I got a live show in 5 minutes. I got to get this thing done.
Finish this thing.
Yes.
You can't wait for the login screen to like just twirl at you for a while or.
Yeah. Yeah. And I have been extremely impressed with how snappy Plasma has been, like just super snappy with how reliable I have noticed a slight continuous uptick in memory usage. So I'm now using about a gig at resting more than I was a few days ago.
Uh-huh.
But that can be explained by a lot of things.
Sure. And how much, what did that peak at?
Well, so far it's just sort of been steadily increasing because, you know, who's got time to reboot?
Yeah, rebooting.
Who's got time, right? So I was really excited when Plasma 5.9 was announced. And the KDE project says they're kicking off 2017 in style with Plasma 5.9. Now, producer Michael, you're not by any chance running it already, are you? Because I know you on Neon.
Yeah, I got it.
Yeah. All right. Without any further ado, are you ready for this?
Oh, I think I am.
I'm very excited. The Plasma guys once again contacted me and had me record the video. I'll just play a little bit.
Awesome.
I just do the voice work. They do everything else, yep. So it's great. It's
they
perfect.
Make the cool software.
Yep.
Of work, the KDE community is pleased to announce Plasma 5.9, which brings many improvements and features to your desktop. Global menu bars for applications have returned and can be used with either a desktop panel showing the menu or neatly tucked away in the window bar. Due to popular demand, we implemented switching between Windows and Task Manager using the new Meta Key plus Number Key shortcuts for heavy multitasking. It is now possible to create comprehensive look and feel desktop themes that will download all the extras needed from the KDE store, such as color schemes and Plasma themes.
I can never win, Wes, because they just released Plasma 5.9, and here I'm thinking, I'm going to go Plasma 5.8 LTS. I'm going to go 5.8, I'll stick with 5.8, and then they ship 5.9, like days later.
They get you all excited about these features and
improvements. What are they doing to me?
Yep.
What are they doing to me? So I don't know. Does anybody in the mumble room want to jump in on Plasma desktop before we move on? I think it's a fantastic release. Lots of improvements, little things that make theming nicer, and whatnot.
It's not, well... I have been using Plasma 5 since 5.4,
yeah.
And it has only gotten it's more stable and more awesome every single release. I'll have one machine that's going to stay on 5.8 just to keep testing it, but 5.9 is a solid option, and I think it's actually a fantastic thing that they have an LTS version of their DE.
Yeah,
and with Neon LTS, you basically get both LTS for Ubuntu and LTS for Plasma. So but if you don't want to have the latest version of Plasma, you can also just use the regular Neon, and you'll still have Ubuntu LTS, but you'll have Plasma will keep rolling, which is awesome.
Yeah, I've been tempted by it. It's on my short list now.
Especially if you have the Ubuntu stuff, so you can do snaps or PPAs as well for that software availability.
We're going to talk more about...
I've tried snaps in it, and it works fantastic.
Yeah, you see, so we're going to talk more about that coming up a little bit in the show, because that is, I think, honestly, it's getting to the point where that is a genuine consideration, especially for, like I said earlier, a five-year distribution. So it's really nice. I think it's one of their best releases yet. And if anybody else wants to comment on it, you can, but otherwise, I'll just leave a link in the show notes. The video covers pretty much everything. I really like that. I think a lot of more open source projects should do that. And if I have the time, I'm making myself available to open source projects that want to make a video, but they don't have somebody to do the voice work. Maybe they don't have a good audio setup or whatever. Totally willing to do that for people. As long as I can fit it in, like in a couple of hours on a Friday, I'll do it for you.
And it really seems like that's the kind of fit and finish that kind of goes the extra. You know, you're like 90%, the software's awesome, they have a good website. But that makes it seem like a very professional organization, Gnome, which it is.
I think Gnome's been doing it for a while, right? So it makes sense that the Plasma desktop.
Yeah.
Gnome started it, and then all of a sudden they released, KDE released a video that was terrible. You made fun of it, and all of a sudden they're like, oh, maybe we should fix that.
Yeah. And Wimpy, I know you've got a lot of community members that make spotlight videos of the Mate desktop and of Ubuntu Mate. Is this an area you've considered going down to help promote the distro, or do you feel it's not necessary?
It is something I've considered doing, yes. But it's a matter of having time and having something that's demonstrable and, usable for something like that. So we haven't done anything professional. We will in the future. We're just getting to the point where we've got enough crowdfunding coming in that maybe over the course of a year we could put a little bit aside each month and do something like that. But I'd rather use the money that's coming in to work on the development stuff.
I agree. I think that makes sense.
Mate 2.0. We've got these community members.
Yeah, it seems like every now and then there might be a few banner releases or features where it might be worth the effort or the trouble.
As if I wasn't busy enough for organizing something like that.
We need to just have somebody do. You know, actually, Wimpy, not that you have all the free time in the world, but you'd be really good at voicing a video.
Oh yeah, I'd watch that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's another thing I've all the time in the world for.
Yeah,
as well.
I know.
I'll just do a British accent myself.
Yeah, that's pretty good. All right, so Ajax, you had a question about about Plasma versus other desktops. Are you in the mumble room? Do you want to? Yeah, you are. Go ahead, X.
Yeah, I'm not a new Linux user, but I have been using Ubuntu for a while, and I'm just kind of looking to branch out. And I'm wondering, you know, how better is Plasma, and you know, what's the best way to go, and why do you think it's better?
Well, I'll just tell you my personal. I'm not going to say anything's better than anything else, but I'll tell you what I like about the Plasma desktop. First and foremost, it's very smooth. Everything renders very smoothly. The windows open really smoothly. But what I think I really enjoy now about the Plasma desktop the most is all of the like the tons of crazy ass configuration options that were wrong by default for so many years with the Plasma desktop are basically all set to sane defaults now. And so you can get one of the most incredibly powerful desktops, and everything is powerful. The terminal is one of the best terminal apps. I love the way I love Console. It is such a great terminal app. The way it handles tabs, the way I can easily send input to multiple tabs at the same time. Dolphin is a super fast file manager. When I have directories that have tens of thousands of files, it just simply renders them and loads them better than Files does, even though I like Files still. Dolphin also has like great features like side-by-side pane support with a terminal built into the file manager, which is great for me when I'm working on a filter. So I really like the file management aspects of Dolphin. I like the KIO slave. So I have, for example, I have a KIO slave where I take a screenshot of something, it automatically uploads it to Imgur and copies the link to my clipboards, and I just toss it right in the show notes.
That is slick.
Little things like that that I can automate that are really nice. There's things I miss about GNOME, but for me, each little application you go down, they're generally more feature rich. There are things about the Plasma desktop that I miss that I feel like I could probably work around. The biggest thing I really like on Unity and GNOME and really anything that uses the files or GTK file browser, even Thunar does this, is when I click on a Samba share, uses GVS to mount it to my file system. And then I can use VLC and whatever else I want to watch video files. I don't
and even go to the terminal and interact
with Yes, exactly. It's the path on my terminal, which is huge. I don't know how to accomplish that in Dolphin because Dolphin uses the KIO slaves and it's uploading and downloading files to my server, saving them in a temp directory and then trying to save them back up. So if I try to watch a video in MPV, it tries to pull down the entire video first and then open it up in MPV, which is a disaster. So if I there are some things I don't know how to fix yet, but so many other things are either so much easier to set. Like one of my big frustrations used to have to go to three different places to configure when the screen went to sleep, when the screen locked out, and if the screensaver was turned on. Now it's one spot. So it's streamlined, it's nicer, and also honestly, the Breeze theme has just gotten a lot of nice iterative updates. It looks really good, and GTK applications now look really good on the Plasma desktop. And Breeze has a very good dark theme, and I like a dark theme on my desktop.
Agreed.
And so it's Breeze again. And a lot of the white space issues I had with the Plasma desktop in the past, those have either been cleaned up. Like Dolphin compared to Conker is such a night and day difference. Like if you're coming at the desktop from like the days of Conker and you sit down at Dolphin, it looks like they ripped off the GNOME desktop to some degrees, but only the best parts. And the thing that I really like about it now is with a nice universal dark theme, Plasma widgets that don't crash all the time when I try to edit them, some sane defaults, great performance, super reliable so far, and a file manager that's super capable and actually getting new features and not features removed. Mm-hmm. Let's check on my boxes. Let's check on my boxes, Wes.
I really like what you said about the defaults there because there's a lot of laptops or other things where it's like I can kind of install GNOME and just, you know, even if I don't have time to perfect it, it's very usable by default. And for especially a while, it didn't feel like Plasma was. But now that sells me right there.
Yeah, yeah. So I think if you're gonna play with it, probably play around with Neon just to get a sense of it, and then pick your distribution of choice that matches your use case. There's a lot to consider out there. Neon's one of them, but I hear a lot from the SUSE camp.
Yeah.
I know Kubuntu is still an active project. There's still a lot out there that you can pick and choose from. So yeah, all right, well there you go, there's the Plasma for new update, brand new version 5.90 is out today as we record this episode. So did you see the story? Actually, I saw this story come across the news feed too, and I'm really glad you tagged it for the show, Wes. This gives me an unsettling feeling because I don't feel like we're getting the full story here, but Blackphone Remember the people that make like the super secure Android device with Silent
VPN
OS?
SGP Technologies.
Yes, yep.
Silent Circle.
Silent Circle. Blackphone has been sending out an update to some devices that bricks them, to devices they say that are counterfeit devices. And it looks like, I'm not sure if they're counterfeit, but they weren't bought from a reseller. They were bought off of eBay. I believe they may actually be legitimate used devices.
Sure. That at least seems possible, right, from what we know.
So a reader in Germany contacted Ars after the update bricked one of his phones, which he had purchased through eBay. The Blackphone 2, he said he received in the retail packaging. It looks just like the one that was reviewed on Ars. It worked up to Silent OS version 307. When Silent OS 308 came out, it intentionally bricks the baseband on the device. When contacted, the Silent Circle technical support responded by saying, upon review of the IMEI number you provided, it's been determined that the device is not a genuine Silent Circle Blackphone 2. This device was not sold by Silent Circle or an improved vendor of Silent Circle, and therefore, we are unable to provide any further assistance. So hang up, basically. This is, now, of course, the Silent Circle folks contacted after this story, contacted Ars, and the project management VP said, Silent Circle is aware of unauthorized devices, and we're working aggressively to stop the sale of those anyways, it's imperative for our consumers and companies that we work with directly to use authorized sales partners when purchasing Blackphone 2. I'm not clear if this is used. I'm not clear if these are ripoff phones.
Exactly.
Do you know what bothers me about this story at the core of it? Can you guess?
It's Android.
Well, there's that. No, it's the aspect of the story that bothers me is the, well, we'll just issue an update and brick it.
Yep.
The hell is that? Like,
if I can't use your software, but...
Don't allow me to click to your cloud servers. Don't allow me to get updates from your Silent
Circle.
Maybe
I want to still flash something else once I realize that it was a fraudulent phone, but it's still a phone.
Maybe I still want to call 911 when I get in a car accident. It's unbelievable how we have no sovereignty over our own devices anymore. Samsung, bricking notes.
I really think that highlights the different way we think about mobile devices and Android phones than a regular PC.
The mistaken way. Yeah, it highlights the mistaken way, the way we've been tricked.
It's a whole product. It's not like composable things that you could maybe repurpose.
We've been bamboozled. We've been bamboozled. We really have been bamboozled. Like, we just accept it like it's a toaster or something. Yeah. These devices are sometimes the most important devices people have in their lives. They're get ready for this, Wes. More important than their PC. Shocker.
This is Linux Unplugged. How dare you?
And if you're somebody out there buying a black phone, you probably like really care about this stuff. Like, it's like extra. You're not like your average consumer. Like, this stuff's important to you. And so to have it be disabled, even if it's a knockoff, that doesn't justify bricking the device. It's still a useful Android device. Mm-hmm. Push an alert message. Send me some sort of unauthorized, like, even Microsoft with illegitimate versions of Windows doesn't go this far. They might force you to reboot. They might put a watermark in your lower corner, but they won't nuke your PC.
And if they did, I mean, it would be crazy.
It's a monster, Wes. This, what we have created as consumers, and it's our fault. It is our fault. What we have allowed to be created as consumers, what we let Steve Jobs bamboobles us all into, is our own fault. I really believe it. Because if we as consumers would stand up and say something or refuse to buy devices that can be remotely bricked, this wouldn't be happening. Instead, we have devices that have God knows what on the baseband, can't even be controlled by the operating system.
Whole other thing.
The vendor who buys it can choose to brick it whenever they want. Samsung. Now Blackphone. Who's the next Android vendor who's going to just remotely disable a phone?
And maybe that'll be the new thing, you know? Oh, no more security updates. You're out of service anymore. Oh, you've had your phone for more than 2 years. It's just going to stop working entirely.
Yeah. Fader says he prefers it. And I think the argument would be that these are supposed to be ultra secure phones. And so if they're...
Yeah, there is an argument there. That's my point.
Yeah. But I feel like I've addressed that in my proposal. My proposal is this. Disable connecting to TCP/IP. Disable the TCP/IP stack. My proposal is send an alert in the Android notification that says, this device is not an authorized device. It is not to be considered secure. But reflashing the baseband so that it simply just doesn't work, that could cost somebody their life. Somebody could be stuck in a car accident and not able to call for help. Like, that is a step too far. And I don't blame Blackphone. I don't blame Samsung because they're really in these horrible situations. Like, Blackphone doesn't want counterfeit products out there. Samsung doesn't want note devices blown up in your pocket so you can sue them and give them more bad press. So they're really in a rock and a hard spot. It's not like they're evil. Go ahead.
How many people, while they're drowning in a car, do a firmware update on their phone?
Drowning in their car? No, you do the update. You get in the car to go to work, and you get in a car accident. It's like, it's not that crazy of a scenario, right?
No, and I agree with you that this is lunacy. I think it's small company arrogance that they think they can do this. Like a large company like Amazon tried this, like tried to reaching into Kindles many years ago.
Yeah, right, right.
Deleting files from other people, from consumer devices. And look where that got them. They've never done it since. But this seems like the small company arrogance of we've made a fantastic product and you should appreciate the support we're giving you. Not we'll just throw, not the Chinese arrogant, the Chinese method, which is throw a bazillion devices out there and we don't really give a crap about them once they've left the factory. It's the opposite. They're caring too much about devices, whether they know about them or not.
That's a great point. And I also like the idea from the chat room that that could be a new action movie cliche, like somebody drives off a bridge, their car is sinking, but their phone is in the middle of installing an update, the monthly Android update. It's the new cliche.
This is like a really boring Black Mirror.
Even the car could be doing an update.
Yeah, that's true.
It doesn't even have to be the phone. It could be the car itself doing an update.
And then someone has an Alexa Dot or Echo in the car, and they have to do an update on that as well.
Ajax, you want to take the devil's advocate position? Go ahead, Ajax.
No, I think you guys are generally right, but the thought occurred to me as well. Say you're a big company or a small company, you know, an employer giving this to your employees, and you're working, you know, working against corporate espionage and doing some really important stuff. Do you want your employees to be able to override that? Like, do you want, maybe as an employer, you bought the Blackphone because you want it to break if it's not completely secure?
Right. And if I'm the company that owns the devices, I get to say that. It's not the manufacturer of the device that gets to say whether my employees can use their devices or not. It's me as the employer, the owner of the device. It's always the owner of the device that should have control over the device, not the manufacturer of the device.
That's my line. That right there. That's my line in the sand. That's exactly it. It is. I feel like I should have root access over every device I own whenever it's feasible. Maybe I could understand like the car. Maybe. But that's, you know, even like the Echo, I feel like I should be able to go into like some sort of settings mode, activate developer mode, and SSH into my Echo and be able to control it.
Tweak things.
Yeah. There's we talked about it in Linux Action Show. There's there's some state laws that could help in the US, but I don't know how optimistic I really am.
I don't know. Yeah. I see cars as like a lethal weapon. It can be used as a missile on the road, but I don't see a phone as being a lethal weapon.
Right.
I can see how someone might argue that the phone might shout out while you're throwing it. Don't throw me! Don't throw me! You know, it's against the end user license agreement to use it as a missile. I don't know.
If
it's a note, it's okay.
Bitmux, you want to go? Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm here. I was thinking, you know, maybe we could reverse engineer the bricking system and just intentionally do the Galaxy Note 7 thing. Someone steals your phone, you just blow it up in their pocket.
Right. I actually think that'd be great. Like, remote destruct. I'm not saying don't have it. Let me control it.
Ooh, yeah, there you go.
I like that, Bitmux. That's good.
What if a kid takes it? Now you think it's with a burglar.
Now it's a weapon.
It's in the hands of a kid.
And blow up the kid. No, that's no good.
That's no good.
Yeah, you got it. With great responsibility comes great explosions. I'm not quite sure how that saying goes. It was something my uncle once told me.
This is not a morality podcast.
All right. Well, while we're still talking about mobile, even tangentially, let's take a minute and mention our sponsor, Ting. In fact, I'd like to mention linux.ting.com. Why? Oh, I'll tell you why. Because you get to save $25 off a device or $25 in service credit if you bring a device. And speaking of voting with your wallet, this is how you do it. Ting's no contracts, no early termination fee, and you only pay for what you use.
Ting keeps rates simple. We don't make you pick a plan. Instead, you just use your phone as you normally would. How much you use determines how much you pay each month. You can have as many devices as you want on one account. That's good, because when you use more, you pay less per minute, message, or megabyte of data. Your usage, plus $6 per active device on your account, plus taxes, is your monthly bill. Simple. That's what we mean when we say mobile. That makes sense.
You know what Kyra doesn't mention? Really great customer service.
Oh, yeah.
Top-notch customer service. You speak to a human. They talk to you. They fix your problem. They stick with you. They follow up. I know it sounds like almost ridiculous and unbelievable to say, but they, Wes, by God, they actually care.
They do.
It's like that's what their job is, and they take it seriously. It's
like
remarkable.
They're passionate about building a business that helps people.
You know, what's great about it is they're backed by Two Cows, which has been around since before the dot-com crash. I mean, these guys have really dialed it in and figured out how to do this stuff. Two Cows also runs Hover, another company I'm a huge fan of. I use them for all my DNS registration now. They've really figured out how to build sustainable companies that feature the customer first. So they have a great control panel. They have CDMA and GSM you can choose from. They don't mess around with early termination fees, no contract shenanigans, $6 a month for the line, and your usage, plus whatever Uncle Sam's going to take. That's it. Linux.ting.com. Go there. Check them out. You cord cutters out there, check out their blog. Also, you tweeters out there, check out their Twitter feed. They are following some of the rumors about Android One coming to the U.S. on their Twitter feed, amongst other things, like sometimes giveaways and whatnot. They are twitter.com/tingftw if you'd like to follow them. And check them out. They also have a subreddit.
Yes, they do.
They're all over the web.
They're so hip over
there. YouTube channels, Google Plus pages. They got it all. But you start by going to linux.ting.com. That supports the show. And saves you some money, linux.ting.com. And thank you to Ting for sponsoring the Unplugged program. All right, let's pick up the pace and keep moving. We've been talking about a lot of stuff. One of the things that is in my hot little, actually, it's in Wes's hot little hands right now, is a rig that we have in for review at this moment. Go ahead, Wes, open her up.
Oh, this is beautiful.
So Wes right here has got himself the new XPS 13.
Yeah, who needs it when I got this new band?
I know, yeah. The XPS 13 Kaby Lake, it's got an i7 in it. It's got the PCI SSD 4K screen. It's currently running Ubuntu 16.04 with Unity as the desktop. I'm just kind of using it in the default configs. What are your first thoughts when you pick it up, you look at it? What do you think? And you have which edition, XPS Sputnik-y thing? You have like a...
It's one of the first.
Yeah, you have like the first,
it's
and I
the
have
first
like
and second, yeah.
I have like the second or third, and this is the sixth. This is the sixth.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's well made. I mean, and they've like not a radical departure from the one that you have in terms of the body, but
mm-hmm. Yeah, it's pretty
it feels
similar there.
It's very sturdy. I haven't done much on it, but
yeah.
Wi-Fi connected.
Yeah.
And it's very snappy.
Yeah, it's...
The screen is nice.
The screen is very, very nice. There is a sort of a premium build feel about it, too. Like, listen, this is just... Listen to this. You feel that? You know it? That's a nice, solid thud when it closes, right?
I was immediately impressed by, like, adjusting... The amount of resistance, adjusting the display.
Right. The display is on there. I like the way
it
goes back.
Hinge.
And, yeah, it is... Look at that. Look at that.
Rock solid.
I'm sitting there bouncing it, buddy. Yep. I'm bouncing it up and down.
That is not moving.
No, it's great. And also a touchscreen, which, you may or may not use, but it's there.
And Unity does work pretty well with that.
Interestingly, so I've had my family... I've had Hadia using this. I've had Dylan using this. And interestingly enough, both of them just sort of intuitively, when they're like browsing Amazon or in Dylan's case, YouTube, reach out and scroll.
Interesting.
Or when Dylan and I are sitting here both using this computer together and there's something he wants to look at, he just reaches out and touches it. And he didn't even know it was a touchscreen. I don't think I said anything to Hadia either. And I saw them both like sitting there on their lap and they're using it to scroll through web pages. So the touchscreen.
I can see that for the consuming side, you know, and like when you don't have it docked ready. So what's the port situation like?
Well, so here's what we got, Wes. You got yourself a Thunderbolt USB-C style port. I think, I don't know, I haven't really tested it yet, but yeah, it's USB-C shaped. Then you've got USB 3.0, headphone jack out. It's also got a little battery gauge on the side, so you can...
Oh,
does yours still have that, too? Is that something they've had since the beginning?
Oh, yeah. Mine has that as well.
Yeah. Yeah, mine does, too, which I just like. I like being able to hit a button on the side of the laptop and seeing what the battery is. It's got an SD card reader, and then it also has another USB port on the other side. So two USB 3.0 ports, SD card reader, USB-C, which has the Thunderbolt icon on it, although I have not tested that under Linux. But I have used USB-C. So I know that works,
that's awesome.
But I have not used Thunderbolt because I don't have any Thunderbolt stuff that has the USB-C plug. But
oh,
it has.
Yeah, I guess I don't either.
But you see, it has that little Thunderbolt icon, little logo next to it.
Oh, yeah.
The plug there. So yeah, that's interesting.
What is this weird future we live in?
I know, USB-C future, man. It's something.
I gotta say though, that is a handsome device. I would be proud to take it anywhere.
Yeah. Yeah, it is, exactly.
It's not like the old Dells where you're like, well, yeah, I mean, I bought it. It wasn't that expensive, and it works for me, but it doesn't look that great. It's not like that.
Yeah, yeah. I'm first impressions are pretty good in all those regards. So I've been getting my family's impression. I've been using it. I'm gonna reload it pretty soon with a different distro and just different desktop environment, see what that's like. Because I always like to, you know, both in a lot of can't think of anybody that doesn't ship the hardware preloaded with Ubuntu. I mean, everybody does, right? I mean, the ones that obviously come to mine are System 76. They ship it with Ubuntu, but all my System 76 rigs, I've generally at some point loaded other distributions on there. Even if I go back to Ubuntu or specifically Ubuntu Mate,
right,
I still sometimes run Arch for a little bit or Fedora or anything else. And so it's nice to know the general compatibility with Linux too, not just the Ubuntu compatibility. But so far, the out-of-the-box stuff, top-notch.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and I came across this for the previous version of the XPS.
Last JS.
Which is, actually, no, did I come across this or did you? Because you and I found some of the same links. Yeah. This, I can't remember, but this is getting macOS on the XPS 13, the 9350 edition. So I thought I'd just drop this in there. For those of you who are crazy enough to do that, that's a thing.
Hey, look at those K extensions.
Yeah, have fun with that after the next update comes out. Then also what showed up on Reddit/r/Ubuntu is a review of the XPS 15 Kaby Lake with the NVIDIA 1050, mm-hmm. which is now starting to get into the range of like an actual like computer I'd really want to consider. And this is not an official Dell-supported configuration, I don't believe, but I think our local resident Wimpy has messed around with the XPS 15 running Linux and has had some good success, right, Wimpy?
I have. I've got the 5th generation 13 and the XPS 15.
Okay. So, and have you had any problems running Linux on the XPS 15, even though Dell doesn't ship it in that config?
No, because the Dell reseller I got it from offered configuration options that included the exact same Wi-Fi card as is in the XPS 13.
Nice.
So it just, everything else is the same apart from the Wi-Fi chipset in that model, and therefore it just works.
Huh. Okay, so that was what you kind of have to take away from that, I think, is make sure you get the... This is the thing. If you go off with
I think that was then, though. I think now they only sell the models with both models of Wi-Fi chipset compatible with Linux. Oh.
Yeah, okay. It looks like in this review, this guy didn't have to fight with wireless either. WW, you had a question about the 13?
Yeah, have you used it under a heavy load? Because I've heard people in our own IRC room that have used it under a heavy load and had a coil whine issue because when the fan kicks up so fast and high that you hear kind of a whining from it.
Yeah, I'm actually gonna specifically test that because I've heard that from the community as well. So it's interesting that you've picked up on that too. So the only real heavy load I've put it under, which did kick the fans a little bit, is we watched a 4K YouTube video.
Oh, okay. HTML5.
Didn't hear any whine then, but it was literally for like 3 minutes. So I'm going to do like some extensive testing. What is a good way other than like Prime 95 or something from like the ancient days? Is there like a really solid like run this command and it generates a lot of CPU usage besides building software?
I think there's a version of the Heavens Engine benchmark for Linux.
Oh, yeah, okay.
You could possibly use.
Yeah.
I will check it now.
I can definitely figure out ways to cause CPU usage, but I would like to do sustained like minutes.
Just keep compiling that kernel for your MacBook.
Yeah. Yeah, right? So that's something to try, but yeah.
Worth noting, there's two things. There's a good benchmark for Onyx Test Suite.
Yep.
Which will like run a whole bunch of games and all kind of stuff.
Yep.
But the thing to note is the coil whine is nothing to do with the fan.
Oh, okay.
It even under no load whatsoever, the coil whine in the really old ones it would just whistle just gently enough to be really annoying, but under no load at all.
Oh boy.
I've not experienced this on either of mine.
Oh boy.
I'd add as well.
I guarantee you I would be hypersensitive to that. So if
it's one of those things like the first time you hear it and then you're done. Before it was fine and then
yeah. 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 Because you know, I can I know a lot of you are like this, so I'm not trying to brag, but I can walk in, I'll walk into a room and I can tell you if a TV screen is on just by the coil wind of the TV screen. It's less prominent now with LCDs, but it's still a thing. And so it's one of those where I would be one of the people in the room going like, what is that noise? And everybody else would be like, what are you talking about, Chris? I'm like, there is something ringing in here. I'm really sensitive to that. And there are entire machines I have stopped using. Librem 15! There are entire machines I've stopped using because of the noise they make. So we'll see. I haven't had that wine. I've not heard any wine yet. I would absolutely tell you if I did, though. Yeah. I don't know. I got to figure out what the price config is on this one, too, to give the... So I haven't done the whole price-to-performance ratio yet. That's stuff good, either. Yeah. So if you're out there and you have one of these machines, I'd like to know what you thought. What you've run into, specifically if you've had any issues around Kaby Lake, any that kind of stuff.
Right, yeah.
Because I...
New chipset.
Yeah. I used to, for years, was like, oh, yeah, no, it's no problem with Intel stuff. But then you know, Skylake came around. Yeah. And there was some problems. Yeah. Speaking of problems, are you just trolling me with this next one, Wes?
Yeah, I think so.
Yep. Are you really? Yeah, legit? Yeah, good man.
I did. I saw it, and I was like, okay, well... I have to at least send this to Chris if not put it in.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's true. At the end of the day, I guess I decided. Yeah, but it was still low. This is so awesome. So we got an update on the ButterFS RAID 5 and RAID 6 status.
This is on the Linux ButterFS mailing list.
Yeah. Their update goes like this. They believe, and this is coming from Jan, and also it's an email thread between Jan and Hugo and others, and they think what they probably should be doing is updating the wiki to reflect the fact that things are way more broken than they initially thought. Like RAID 5 and 6, don't even go near them. There's just some examples. Now, it's in some respect, it's really great they found this stuff.
Yeah.
So there's that. In other respects, the RAID 5 or 6 scrub will repair data while corrupting parity. Kind of ironic. So while you're fixing your data, you will corrupt your parity.
Just trade one corruption for another.
RAID 6 scrub can report false alerts on CSUM errors. The dev replace cancel sometimes can cause an entire kernel panic of your system.
Yep.
And they also are seriously considering re-implementing ButterFS's entire RAID 5, 6 configuration, the entire thing, using Device Mapper, which is tried and true, but old.
Yeah.
So they may be rewriting the entire RAID 5, 6 aspect of ButterFS.
Does that make you want to build a nice big RAID 5 array right now?
Yeah,
right now.
Just go all in on ButterFS right now. I am so stoked about this. When you saw this, Wes, did you laugh? Were you disappointed? Like, what was your? Because my initial reaction was actually a little sad. Like, I was like, oh,
yeah,
we're never gonna get there.
We're never gonna get there. Yeah, it was a little. I mean, I think it was all of those things, right? I was like, it was kind of funny, and I was thinking of you and just some of the quotes from the mailing list.
Of course.
But the part of me is like, I still have a ButterFS RAID 1 system, so I'm glad that they aren't mentioning that in here. There's some mention of it later. But
yeah, there was two links you sent me. What was the second link you sent me?
The second one was just talking about the Chris over at Facebook who has given...
The one that the use case that is always mentioned for ButterFS, right.
Yeah.
The singular use case.
So they just kind of talk about how they've focused in the past on single drive use cases. They may change that this year. Performance, stability, and then maybe RAID 5, 6 are on their list. So we'll see. Maybe if there is a rewrite, Facebook will be involved, but who knows, right? I mean, and that's the thing is, like, really, ButterFS has been relegated to, hey, Intel XFS has snapshots that are, like, fully worked out. Here's some snapshots for your root file system. Don't trust data in any serious NAS array.
XFS, everybody. XFS. If you don't need all the features of ZFS, please consider XFS for your home partition.
It's just a few letters less than Z. It's almost there.
It's close. Yeah. It's damn near close. For maybe your VAR. I don't care. I'm Honey Badger about it. But XFS, my friends, please consider it. And then if you want a grown-up file system that's used in production, ZFS. I'm not even saying that to be antagonistic. It's just the reality now. And... oh, this hurts so bad. This hurts. And remember, I know we are now like a year into Chris bashing ButterFS, but the year before that, I put all my shit on ButterFS. Like my actual, in fact.
I mean, I still have root partitions on ButterFS. Dude, I'm sure you do as well.
The VM server that runs a bunch of the local servers here at Jupiter Broadcasting, is all of that stuff is stored on ButterFS. Like, the back-end data storage is ZFS, but the server itself that's running all that stuff, we are ButterFS all up in this business still to this day. Mm-hmm. And we have Arch machines in those VMs running on ButterFS.
We heard you like ButterFS.
Jeez. And I'm not using any of the RAID features, though. And it's really been fine for
them. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And the systems don't fill the disks a lot. They're running kind of the same thing, the same jobs, the same tasks all the time. And it's actually been fine for that. So while I've been spending a year kind of trash-talking ButterFS, it's just simply because I really want us to be competitive.
Exactly. Yeah, right. That's what it comes down to, is like, it would have been great if ButterFS was the project that could have built a new GPL licensed ZFS that we could use and could be in kernel.
Amen.
That's not what's happened.
Amen. Exactly. That is exactly how I feel about it. And that's exactly what I wanted. And that's why now I say XFS. Wimpy, do you agree?
Yep. I've done for a long time. I've had good success with B3FS on root file systems. Mm-hmm. This was some time ago, but for out and out performance with the compression, it was brilliant. But not because of the issues that have since come to light with B3FS, but I started using F2FS because I've moved to SSD. So F2FS for root file systems, and then XFS for volumes of data.
Will you denoob me? What is that?
F2FS is a file system developed by Samsung, and it's specifically for flash and solid state devices. So it's hot rocking fast on anything from memory cards, USB sticks, and SSDs.
How did you come across this?
It's been around for years.
Yeah, I imagine. I just doesn't ring a bell for me.
It was one of the things I was tinkering with when I was trying to build an OS based on Arch for the Raspberry Pi years ago. And this was a way to get better performance. And the only drawback with F2FS is that it doesn't have all of the user space tools. So, for example, there's no file system resize capability at the moment.
Get it right the first time.
So you get it right the first time.
Been there. Will you put a link to that in the show notes, Wes? Because I saw you just found that there.
Yes, I will.
Yeah, I'm very fascinated by these and Bcache FS and others that.
Yeah, and that's the one that I tinker with on a spare machine, and that's my little hobby file system that I like to keep up to speed with. Yeah,
I fantasize about the position that folks like yourself, Wimpy, and folks like Ryan at System 76 are in, where I all of a sudden have to make the decision what potentially thousands upon tens of thousands of users may use as their default. And that is such a head job for me. Like, when it comes to the responsibility of choosing a file system, like, there is not, when it comes to your core foundation, once you've chosen Linux, you've made the hard choice. Now it's like, what distro and what file system? And you choose, generally people choose Ubuntu or Ubuntu Mate. Mm-hmm. And then you choose your file. And that's like, those are the three big choices in my world. And I can't imagine, like, every time I get in that position, I think, well, you just do extended 4. Because nobody gets fired for shipping extended 4.
That's the way to think about it.
Or you're SUSE and you do ButterFS. And then you spend the rest of the year defending ButterFS into oblivion. But I digress. Would you ever consider, okay, let me, what, Wimpy, what would it take before you would flip the bit to make XFS the default file system for future, like, 1810, say it's Ubuntu Mate 1810, what would it take to convince you to flip the bit to XFS for the default file system?
It wouldn't take anything to convince me, but it's not a decision that I could make alone, because it would be something that would affect all of the flavors, so there would have to be a consensus of opinion.
Oh, it's a flavor. It's all Ubuntu's that would switch.
Yeah, yeah. Because
I didn't know that.
A feature. It's a feature of Ubiquiti. Yeah.
Oh. And we have kernel developers who are quite anti ButterFS for good reason. They've done a lot of testing, like pulling out the cable while it's running, kind of testing.
Do you mean B3FS or XFS?
ButterFS. Sorry.
Fine.
Yeah. Yeah. That's interesting, Poppy. That's mm-hmm. that, and so I guess the flip side to that is, So you could frame it as, well, we can't do XFS until all Ubuntu's do XFS. But the flip side of that is, once Ubiquiti has drop-down checkbox support for ZFS, then all of the flavors get it. Right, Wimpy?
Yeah, and there is a capability to put plugins into Ubiquiti so you can have additional steps in the install installer. And the only flavor I'm aware of that ever did that was Mythbuntu, so that you could configure the back end and front end components individually during the install. So it might be possible that using a plugin that could be overridden. I'm not sure anything like choosing the file system is exposed in the plugin or not. I think that's a separate piece. But yeah, I'd happily go with XFS. I mean, it's proven itself over many, many years now.
I didn't really think about that. That is an interesting, because you'd really come down to having to either do a plugin if they didn't have plugin support for the file system, and you really were, you know, you were really serious about this, you'd essentially have to fork Ubiquiti to pull this off. You know, those are the kind of things I haven't thought about. But so the choice is sort of made for you in some sense, but the net gain overall is totally worth it.
Yeah, but when I install my machines, I just do the manual partitioning and just set everything up with XFS anyway.
Mm. Yeah, I usually do the same.
Ryan, do you know if anybody over there at System 76 has ever, you know, kicked around the idea of switching around the default file system or switching around something like that? Is there any kind of like a skunk works where people try out new file systems at System 76?
Well, we do try them out, but we typically end up shipping whatever Ubuntu ships by default.
Yeah, that kind of seems like a good bet.
Yeah, it's safe.
Yeah, and also you get the advantage of a huge user base that's all sort of has the same common set of configurations, mm-hmm. and that makes it much easier for people that are looking for support after the fact. So we kind of end up...
Correct.
This is one of those defaults that truly reigns supreme. So we end up with Extended 4, and I suppose if the market came along one day and really wanted something else, we would see a change. But for right now, for what we need, it's getting the job done. All right. Well, speaking of getting the job done, let's talk about Linux Academy. Talk about a really great way to get the job done and learn more. LinuxAcademy.com/unplugged. That's where you go to support the show and you sign up for a free 7-day trial. LinuxAcademy.com/unplugged. Take advantage of a platform built by Linux users for freaking Linux users. That makes all of the difference. Linux and open source isn't one of the many things they cover. It's the only thing they cover. And that really makes a huge difference.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, one of the things I've really liked about Linux Academy is I talked to them before they were really publicly known. And what I walked away from the conversation was, well, we watched Jupiter Broadcasting and we thought, what if we did a podcast network but we made money? And I thought, that's a great idea. I should have thought
that. Yeah.
And I'm like, well, then we kind of kicked that idea around. And this is what we came up with, because they wanted to spread Linux. They wanted more people using it. And they recognized there was this total, total gap in the industry for getting you credible, good Linux training that the rest of the industry would get behind and recognize. And that, to a T, is Linux Academy. They got course schedulers for your busy schedule. They got video courses. They got self-paced study guides. They got downloadable, comprehensive stuff you can take offline, listen in the shower.
That's amazing.
A community full of Jupiter Broadcasting members. Learning paths, which are very specific tracks for your career that are planned out by their instructors. Oh, instructors. Yeah, they've got those too. Full-time humans who are happy to advise and answer questions. Nuggets of just little teeny bits of wisdom when you're busy, and study guides and audio that you can take with you. And a notebook you can keep filled out. And here's the best part, note cards. Take advantage is one of the best things of open source. That is, people forking stuff and making it better. They got those with the note cards. They integrate little things like that, some concepts from the open source community into the platform. It's genius. They've also got iOS and Android apps now, and they're building out content like a mo, adding stuff all the time. I think it's probably one of the coolest companies I've watched grow up over the last few years. And one of the nicest things about Linux Academy is legitimately every single week there's something cool and new to talk about. I love how much stuff they're doing. I love how hard they're hitting it. And I love the results our community is getting. You start by going to linuxacademy.com/unplugged. Sign up for a free 7-day trial. Try it out yourself. See how useful it is. look at the public profiles, see how you can use that to tell management what you've been working on. And then, when you're all done at the end of the day, just sit back and play around with your lab servers. That's what I would do. LinuxAcademy.com/unplugged. And a big thank you to Linux Academy for sponsoring the Unplugged program. What are you doing over there? You just, did you go to sleep and have to wake back up again?
Yeah, that's right, I did.
What does that solve? What problem did you fix by sleeping your laptop and re-waking it?
Sadly, nothing. Nothing.
What's wrong? Did it lock up on you?
Chrome was just being weird. It wasn't like clicking for the mouse at all. So,
what distro? I just tried out a distro recently. Oh, man. I can't remember. I just recently tried out a distro that had Chrome and Chromium installed. Oh, no. Wait a minute. No.
Hold it.
It was the XPS 13. It came out of the box from Dell with Chrome and Chromium installed. Like, what the hell is this about? Like, why do you have... Why do you have Chrome and Chromium? Like, you just do one or the other. And not Firefox. Not Firefox.
So this is a privilege of an OEM that works with Canonical to produce their images.
A privilege? They can install three web browsers?
They can work with Canonical. Well, they can install three browsers. But they can work with Canonical to change what's on the image. They don't have to use the vanilla image. They can actually make customizations.
That is nice.
Oh, yeah. One of the other things I noticed is a pretty slick, actually, really slick boot up animation, music, animation. It makes Ubuntu really feel like a... Do you remember when macOS, way back in the day, had like these welcome to macOS animations that were kind of okay? Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is like those, only way better. It's really
now
well done.
I want
done.
To see this. Wow.
Yeah, yeah. So you boot it up, you get this whole full screen video presentation. But yeah, you do get Chrome and Chromium. And so Wimpy, am I to understand that there is like a back and forth, like we will like, how does that work? Like how are they able to add something? Did they like carve out a deal with Google to redistribute Chrome? Is that what I'm to understand?
I don't know what the arrangement is regarding Google, but I know that what they're able to negotiate as to what deviations they want to make from the vanilla image.
So this doesn't make
it
like
to still be recognized as Ubuntu and supported.
So it's not like it doesn't become like a Dell Ubuntu.
No, Canonical will still recognize it as Ubuntu, and it is supported.
Okay,
that's nice.
Okay, that's nice. I want to just two stories, and then I want to get into some new hardware that's coming out of System 76 that's going to mine all the bitcoins. Did you know that kernel.org back in 1998, but until 1998, you could mount kernel.org via NFS or Samba over the internet?
Yep.
That's fun.
Yeah, yeah. I think I might have done it once. Maybe. And I didn't even know what the hell I was doing back then. And they were
then
just...
Then you ran a magic command and then like a kernel popped out and...
It was just the worst though. Wimpy, did you ever do this?
I remember trying to get it working through our company firewall over NFS once. And about that time, then figured out this was a really bad idea.
Yeah.
And just worked out how to... write a script to make FTP recursively grep.
There you go. Yeah, not NFS and SIFS, not known for their tolerance of high latency connections. Not with their strong end.
No.
Yeah. FTP much better. But it is 2017, and 19 years later, kernel.org is announcing that they are terminating their FTP services. No more FTP for US.
There was a good discussion just about like that FTP can be tricky with firewalls, and some good highlights like they can be sent to random port numbers. They may originate from server or client. Destination addresses are negotiated on the fly. So I can see why it's
weird.
Just like a lot more of a burden to maintain than just use HTTP.
Yeah, but not for them in a way. I guess. As long as they keep rsync up, I'm happy, really, to be honest with you. But and HTTP, I'm good. Yeah, I don't know though, because you know I still have muscle memory for ftp.kernel.org. ftp.kernel.org.
Yeah, that's fair.
That's gonna be weird. But time moves on. Also, moving on. I thought this was sort of interesting, and I'll just link it up in the show notes for you guys. But super quick, if you're like me and you're on a super limited bandwidth connection at home, or maybe you're on a LAN with tons and tons of workstations running Steam. I don't know. Steam Pipe and other utilities like Nginx can be used to locally cache Steam updates, game files, and whatnot on your LAN. Ars Technica has a whole write-up about it that we'll have linked in the show notes. You can only cache games you own, and it caches them the first time you pull them down. So it's not like you can pull, you can't like take Steam Pipe, point it at the Steam Store, pull down all of the things,
and set, just have it right there.
Not
doesn't work that way.
No. And this is like a combination of Nginx and Steam Pipe and other things to help you sort of solve the problem. Maybe you got a LAN game, or you got a whole bunch of machines, or like myself.
Your roommates also use Steam.
There are also times where my MiFi connection in Lady Jupes is super strong, and I maybe want to do this kind of stuff. And then there's times where it's not so good, and it would be nice that when I reset up a machine or I'm trying out a system for review, to be able to just pull them from a local system.
Install Race the Sun.
When do I not?
Yeah.
When do I not? The answer is never. So this is kind of a neat feature, and I don't really have much to add. We're not going to go through the whole how-to here, but if you want to locally cache your Steam games, and who doesn't, right? I also like to have my own local Pac-Man repo, my own apt repo. I mean, come on. Yeah.
Everything. I like having
all the things. So ours has a write-up on that. Now, Wes, when I say System 76, you say...
Fantastic computers running.
I say
Ubuntu.
Oryx too. I say laptops.
Oryx.
I say laptops actually.
Yeah, laptops.
Which is funny.
Although they have desktops.
I know. Some of my first systems, actually my second System 76 machine was a desktop. So I know that. But you know what I haven't said for a while? And every now and then I mentioned on Linux Action Show, but you know what didn't come to the tip of my mind? Servers. But System 76 has a whole line of servers.
I did not know that.
And I have been led to believe that once people have been convinced of the System 76 persuasion, they usually end up coming back looking for more, like servers. I don't know if that's true or not, but Mr. Ryan Sipes is in the mumble room, and perhaps he can confirm rumors of a new iBix Pro. Ryan, is it true? That was Ryan
Sipes.
There it is.
He was too busy playing with the new iBix Pro.
I was on the edge of my seat there for a second. Yeah. That was really good. This is not just any old server though, Ryan, right? Because this is like one that could have like a whole bunch of GPUs in it. This is like a Bitcoin maniac.
8 Tesla P100s, 3,000 CUDA cores. It's a pretty big beast of a machine.
1.5 terabytes of RAM.
I want it.
32 terabytes of SSD storage, if that's your persuasion. Yes. 8 GPUs. Woo! So, Ryan, am I kind of right, though? Do a lot of people, they end up coming to System 76, they buy a desktop, they buy a laptop. Maybe I'm a school district, and all of a sudden I find a lab full of System 76 machines, and next thing I know, I need a server. And people kind of get sort of... they get swayed by the whole System 76 package. Is that a kind of a common entry point for the servers? Or can you talk a little bit about what System 76 is doing in the server space? Because it's not something we talk a lot about.
Sure thing. We offer a full line of servers from your like basic 1U, you know, server that maybe is running, I don't know, like maybe use it as a web server. Maybe it's something that's not really intensive on GPU we offer from the small server all the way up to the new iBix Pro, which is a beast. It's a monster.
My kind of machine.
The thing is that a lot of folks come for the laptops and desktops, but they stay for the awesome server line that we have, and they look to us for our fantastic Linux support when they're considering that type of machine.
GPUs servers.
A lot of them, yeah.
I'm familiar with like scientific workloads. I'm pretty familiar with like live streaming use cases. But I can see, you know, a lot of different server-side workloads coming. I joke about Bitcoin. It's not really what you would use this machine for, but man. I could imagine there's people out there like in the design industry or the scientific community that must need a lot of GPU power, right, Ryan?
Yeah, machine learning and render farms for like 3D video. These are common use cases that we hear about. I've said this before, I think, on the program, but we have some customers who everybody knows who's really big into machine learning, maybe even autonomous driving, those type of companies, and they've been looking forward to us producing a machine like this.
Hmm.
Yeah, now, how about we set up one of those Steam streaming servers? Those GPUs can render yes. it, and then I can just play right here on my laptop.
We'll have the Jupiter Broadcasting streaming service yeah. as one of these things. It wouldn't just be for you and I. It could be for everybody. Yeah, that's pretty great. I think when I picture like the ultimate school district, mm-hmm. I would totally like love like labs with System 76 desktops, secretaries on the all-in-one systems, and office staff all and teacher computers would all be the all-in-one systems, servers on these, not the GPUs, but you know, just right. that kind of stuff.
That would be nice.
That'd be such Ooh. such a sweet setup. So Ryan, you're telling me people are still buying local servers and installing them on premises? I thought everybody went to the cloud.
Well, those cloud providers have to buy their servers from somewhere.
That's true. Yeah, that's very true. And they need more powerful servers than ever, so you guys got to stay busy.
Yeah. Fortunately, we've had really, really great reception to our server line, and the demand just continues to grow. And so we've continued to grow our server line to yeah. meet demand. And so I would encourage anyone who is looking to, who works at a data center or for, you know, a university doing machine learning, protein folding, things that are really GPU heavy to take a look at the IBIX. You know, when you talk about buying time on one of these GPU servers, it isn't cheap. In fact, some of the cloud providers require you to enter into some kind of like amount of time that you have to use it because they have to spin up that thing on site in order to make a instance available to you. And so sometimes this, it seems crazy when you're talking about a machine that can range anywhere from $9,000 to $114,000.
Oh.
But if you're a big, you know, enterprise or university, sometimes having something like this on site can be cheaper than renting time on a cloud service.
Hey man, mine's only $41,000, so I don't know what you're talking about. I configured a system, you know, just for casual usage. Just for casual
usage.
Casual yeah. usage with how many cores did I put in there? Oh, I put 22 cores in there with 44 threads.
You sure that'll be enough, Chris? Maybe you should get two.
Yeah. So that's the new IBIX from System 76. Holy smokes.
I also wanted to bring some stuff up because lots of folks have been really excited to see that we're making a new product release. And I wanted to reiterate that Carl is speaking at UbuCon and will be releasing 3 products while he's on stage. So people who are in the Pasadena area or can make it out there should totally attend that talk.
Cool, man.
Awesome.
And of course, check out the IBIX over at system76.com. I'm just going to, you know, I like anytime you have a system that has a configuration option of first CPU memory and then second CPU memory, and the option is 768 gigabytes of RAM, you're not playing around. This is a serious.
Wow.
Yeah. And
check.
And then the base GPU design is 2,800 cores, you know. And it can go all the way up from there to, like, 39,000 cores. Woo! That is a beast of a system. Wow,
I know what I want for my birthday.
Yeah, that's a whole another level. Speaking of another level, let's talk about our last and final, but you know what? Honestly, the sponsor that I'm using right now as we do this very show, so you can't call them last, and definitely you can't call them the least, they are DigitalOcean! Go over to DigitalOcean.com and use our promo code DOUNPLUGGED. You get a $10 credit, you spin up a rig, try it out. You got an open source project. You got a demo you want to do in a podcast in a few minutes? You do it on a DigitalOcean droplet. Oh, you'll see what I'm talking about. DigitalOcean.com. Use our promo code DOUNPLUGGED after you sign up. You get a $10 credit. You can try out their 3 cents an hour rig. Nice machine.
Ooh.
3 cents an hour is really an unbelievable rate to get a really fast computer with a 40 gigabit E connection. Everything has SSDs, regardless of the price you pay. A brilliant control panel, super smooth, straightforward API, and documentation that is to die for. DigitalOcean.com. Use the promo code DOUNPLUGGED. You create your account. You go in there. You get in there all like a boss. You get your username. You do your email thing. Then you log in. You type in DOUNPLUGGED. You get the $10 credit. You go nuts. Say you get the $5 rate, go crazy for 2 months. I'm not going to judge. I won't tell people what you're doing. I mean, you can tell me what you're doing, but I won't tell them what you're doing. Come on. I know it. It's great. There's so many things, you know, right now, as we record this show, I'm using DigitalOcean to host my IRC. I'm using DigitalOcean to stream this here very
what?
Show. I know. I'm using DigitalOcean to sync the files I'm using to play on this show and to talk about it. And I've been using DigitalOcean this morning to set up the files. I'm using DigitalOcean to talk to our virtual lug because the mumble room runs on a DigitalOcean droplet.
Hey, yo.
There's so many things we use DigitalOcean for. And it doesn't matter if you're a beginner or if you're an expert, you'll find their interface is fantastic. They got data centers all over the world, so even our international audience will find something locally that hyper serves their customers. And then they have some of the best documentation on the web, not because they copied it and set up a wiki, but because they've really worked with their community. They've rewarded the very, let's say, high producing members of the community who create really great content. They've monetarily rewarded them. They've hired full-time, and I'm plural here, full-time editors.
Multiple.
To edit the documentation. Like, they take every aspect of their business super serious. And right now, not only are they rolling out this really nice front-end system to help manage your traffic and spread it across your entire infrastructure, but the beta that I've been playing around with is their monitoring system.
Oh, yeah.
Integrates right in with the dashboard. I can enroll my existing droplets, and I can, quote-unquote, upgrade them to monitoring. Nice, dude.
That's
so nice.
So cool.
Honestly, for us, like, for a couple of our servers, we kind of guessed on how much horsepower we needed to like do live transcoding video, but we didn't really know. And now with this new system, I can get a much better idea. So I can really kind of narrow in on the kind of performance I need. Do I need more? Do I need less?
See if you're pushing it or you're just wasting things.
That's the thing, dude. And it's really nice. DigitalOcean.com. Use the promo code DOUNPLUGGED. It just gets better every single week. And a big thank you to DigitalOcean for sponsoring the Unplugged program, DigitalOcean.com, and use that promo code DUUNPLUGGED. So, Wes, you see my screen right here right now?
Mm-hmm. Oh, what is that? Uh-oh. Is that top?
That's Popey's computer right there. I am logged into Popey's computer using...
fork bump. Come on, fork bump.
You know, RM-RM. No, just kidding.
Knock yourself out, Chris.
Yeah, I know. Popey and I were talking earlier today, and he's like, well, maybe I'll set up a droplet for you, because he doesn't want me to hack his system. But this is using Teleconsole, which is an epic we featured on Sunday. And what's even better than this is, I think, and I'm guessing, but Popey, I think you kind of got involved in this because you found that either you, did you help get involved with the snap, or you found it had a snap? And
yeah, I discovered Teleconsole last week. There was... It featured on Hacker News, and it rose up the GitHub trending projects. And I thought, oh, that looks interesting. Let's take a look. And I contacted their CEO, the company that is called Gravitational, that made Teleconsole, and said, hey, would you like your application snapped and put in the store? And I had a conversation with them on late on Friday night last week, and I'd already snapped it by this point. It was already packaged up as a snap. And I had a chat with them, and they said, seriously, you just want my permission to put it in the store? I said, yeah. He went, do it. So that was it. I put it in the store, and I'll hand it over to them shortly. I've created a pull request on their GitHub repo, so they can take ownership of it. But basically, the directory you're in is just a directory on a like you said, on a DigitalOcean droplet. But in there is a YAML file. If you do an LS,
find
there's a YAML file in there, and that's the config that I created. It's not hugely complex.
Wow,
that's all it took.
Well, I'm gonna look at that again. Look at that. So
yeah, it's
really
like
the 20 thing
lines
that,
or so.
Well, no, I mean, it's less than that if you take out the description.
Well, yeah, if you take out all the metadata, there's like 3 lines.
Yeah,
wow. That made it.
This is so you have copy, and then you have a tar file, and this is made simpler because it's a Go file. I mean, it's a Go program that's pretty much all statically linked. It's all ready to go, so it's not like a ton of extra depths have to be installed.
Right.
But this is. I mean,
you're running this in a web browser. You're connected over a web browser.
Yeah, we're using Teleconsole.
So that's
cool, amazing.
Thing. So
yeah.
This is the cool thing. We're using Teleconsole to talk about Teleconsole. So I just installed Teleconsole snap from the store and then ran Teleconsole, and it gave me a URL. I gave that to Chris, and he could open that URL in a browser and then look at my machine and actually interact with the machine. So I can sit here, and this is great for providing support. If you've got family members who have got an Ubuntu machine they can install Teleconsole, or whenever they need help, they can run Teleconsole, give you the URL, you can connect, and there's no port forwarding, there's no SSH keys or any of that nonsense. And you did mention on Laz that it is possible to do this with a GitHub ID, mm-hmm. but you can do it without that. You can just give them a URL. And
which is what we did here.
It's brilliant.
And what's fascinating is if Poppy, right, if you resize your window on your side, does it resize it on my side? Like it's... It is very much what I see.
Do you want to make it smaller or larger?
Try making it a little tiny. Try making a hair larger. Does it? Are you just you're just dragging the window on your screen right now?
So I'm just grabbing the terminal window and I've just made it slightly bigger.
Yeah. Oh, that's so cool. That is so great. And then you can revoke the session essentially and kick
right.
me out.
I can just press Control D and it will exit out of Teleconsole and I'm done. Or I can close the window because it's just a terminal. But it's just. So nice.
Yeah.
It's really, really nice.
What I gravitate towards here is more and more things like this are showing up as snaps. And this is why I think I'm probably for my 5-year bulletproof distro gonna end up on Ubuntu Derivion.
Yeah,
of some sort of Derivion of Ubuntu. I don't know if it's Neon, I don't know if it's Ubuntu Mate, I don't know if it's Ubuntu proper. Right now on the XPS I'm running Ubuntu proper. But this kind of thing. Between PPAs, snaps, apps, and maybe even Flatpaks, that is a whole range. And Docker. It's a whole range of applications that are really simple, really easy to get going. And there's more and more stuff I'm seeing showing up as a snap
package.
Seems
to be picking up, yeah.
And if there's people listening to this thinking, oh, I'm on Ubuntu 14.04 and I really want to have a go with this Teleconsole, well, SnapD landed in 14.04. like yesterday.
Oh wow,
really?
Oh,
really?
So
if
you, yeah, so if you
with isolation
install, yep,
really,
so if you apt-get install SnapD on 14.04, you'll get SnapD and the confinement bits and pieces and an uplifting kernel to kernel 4.4, and then you can snap install to your heart's content as well.
Oh man, what is what is toilet? Is that what is toilet?
It's like it's like Figlet. Figlet is like a font thing that lets you put big banner text, and toilet is just similar.
Yeah, so
I don't know why, but it's great.
So I could, not only can I remotely control Poppy's machine, but he
can now control the stream.
So this is great. Like you can have two people can have a text editor open at the same file.
Sure.
Two people can like cooperate on the same thing.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just amazing. I love it.
Maybe this is what we do tomorrow. Now our plans have been scuppered. We use this.
Yeah, we can work together remotely via a session via Teleconsole. It's great.
Yeah, really, it is perfect for support. It is perfect for collaboration, and it feels. So when we covered this on last on Sunday, I got the typical, well, this is just the perfect way to get hacked type responses, and I understand where people are coming from. But one of the things I like about Teleconsole as opposed to giving somebody straight SSH access to your machine is it's session ID based and you can revoke sessions. So you actually, in some regards, have more control over who has access to your machine using Teleconsole. And because you can watch them, you literally have more oversight.
I will say then that goes back. I think we talked about it briefly on the show a while ago. The backing technology, it's basically a demo for Gravitational's Teleport, which is their own SSH daemon implementation. And so if you're using one of our fine sponsors and you have your own infrastructure where maybe you want this kind of auditability or control or seamless access for devs who aren't as, Linux friendly, you can use Teleport or things like this to get similar functionality in your own infrastructure.
Slick, Wes. Okay. That makes sense. That's a great way to do it too.
And that's the next step is I've taught the guys how to do a snap for Teleconsole. The next step is that they're going to make a snap out of Teleport. So
that's
that
awesome.
You could have your own on-premises Teleport or in a DigitalOcean droplet.
I really like, Poppy, how simple the YAML file is. So the YAML file describes to Snap what it should do. It's like the instruction file. And it is ridiculously simple when something is a tar file that is essentially statically linked or doesn't have a lot of dependencies.
Right.
But you could, if you wanted to, in this YAML file, couldn't you even pull crap off of like an FTP site? To install.
Right. You can pull from anywhere. And there are way more complicated. I mean, this is one of the more simple ones. Mm-hmm. If you actually type Snapcraft in that window right now, it will build the snap. It will just open the YAML file and create the snap straight away. Oh, hello. Oh, you haven't got it installed. Well, you got to add to
this. Well, let me install some software on your computer really quick remotely.
That's what computers are for.
Yeah, this feels good. I like installing software on other people's computers.
So, yes, you're right. And some of the more complicated snaps are pulling in libraries from here and there or building something from source, and it can get a lot more complicated. It was quite beneficial that when I saw this last week, I looked at it and thought, well, that's a Go binary. It's a single binary mm-hmm. that implements sure. the entire solution as one thing. And, oh, hello. What's going on there? Oh, man.
Yeah, that's
broken.
Yeah.
Well, okay. You would normally just type Snapcraft and it will build it.
So, Ryan, you have had, you have installed several or some snaps on your system?
Yeah, I've been trying to install via Snap first before I install via any other method. And I thought I would have a really bad time just because it's still growing and things are changing.
Yeah,
but,
sure.
Generally, I've had a good experience. In fact, so good that I've been working on a game with somebody else in the System76 community, and it's called Codebreakers. You can snap install Codebreakers right now, and we snapped that up, and it was a lot of fun, and it works really well.
Cool. I didn't even realize I was actively using snaps until this morning when I did a mount command and saw I had three snaps mounted. And I realized, oh yeah, I have three.
Yes, I've noticed that as well.
I have three Snap apps installed on my machine upstairs, and I didn't even, you know, once you get them loaded up and
set.
Yeah,
they're on your path, and it works fine.
Yeah, it just totally works fine.
They also update as part of, like, the normal update procedure, which I guess I didn't really realize.
Oh, they do?
And so, yeah, I mean, like, as part of the update, it must run the Snap command, but there's been times when somebody has been like, oh yeah, go ahead and update this package, and you'll have the new sweetness. And I go to update, and it's like everything's up to date. And I'm like, well, I didn't run Snap refresh, but apparently, and somebody can correct me if I'm wrong, but I've always had just through running normal updates, always had the up to date snaps.
Interesting. I have not ran a single Snap command on my workstation upstairs since I installed them. So I should look at that on Arch because I don't know what the situation is on Arch. Yeah, I installed them a while ago and I think I forgot about them. And I don't want that to be what happens with those types of applications because mm-hmm. that's a recipe for disaster. So I should try
walk
to
the walk, Chris. Walk
I know.
The walk.
I know. I forgot. Yeah, I totally. Honestly forgot I did it. And I'm so used to my package manager installing everything else.
Exactly.
I didn't even think about it. But they've been running great. So there's that. Teleconsole combined with Snap combined with that GitHub thing is a pretty powerful
future.
And I really think I'm feeling inclined to use a distribution that supports snaps, but I'm kind of feeling inclined to use an Ubuntu based distro with Flatpak snaps, PPAs, app files. They're just in the general repo. I mean, like, all that stuff is just really appealing to me. Mm-hmm. What are you working on? Jeez, Poppy.
Sorry, I just fixed that in the background while you were talking.
Yeah, you did.
There
I looked down at my screen. Yay. Okay, cool. Look at that. See, that's what's so great about this right there. Boom, you just have Poppy fix things for you.
Next time you have a problem, boom, fire up Teleconsole.
Now Poppy's Twitter feed will be filled with, Poppy, help me. That is really neat. And I noticed, too, that they have an EU-specific server for Teleconsole. EU.teleconsole.com. Well, anything else, Poppy, you want to touch on before we move on?
No. If you want some fun that's not command line stuff, I also pushed a game to the Snap Store called Oh My Giraffe. So if you Snap install Oh My Giraffe, then it's not something I've written. It's someone, another guy wrote, and I offered to Snap it for him and put it in the store. And it's a fun game. So yeah, Oh My Giraffe, Snap install Oh My Giraffe. It's great.
You know, before the show, I tried to figure out how I would install Teleconsole as a Snap. Is there like a website the audience should go to find a list of the latest snapped up applications?
So the goal really is for us to once an upstream has got something snapped and it's in the store, is to update their documentation basically, so that rather than it say go and get this source and build this source or add this PPA, it just says snap install foo, right? Mm-hmm. Because that's the easiest way to do it. So once the upstream for Teleconsole has taken over ownership of this and it's not mine, we'll get them to update their documentation so that it says snap install Teleconsole, blah, blah, blah.
I should have just used the snap command to search for Teleconsole instead of searching the web, too. That would have, I don't know what I was thinking. I was being a noob. I was being a snap noob. That's what the
problem. Work on it.
I know. I got to get my S together.
Next week, you better snap install something live on the show. Prove that you know how.
Okay. You better remind me because I'll forget.
About snaps, about everything.
All right. Well, that's pretty cool. I love it. I love it. So thanks, Popey, for at least dedicating a machine, sacrificing a machine.
Let Chris.
Yeah, I'm going to burn it with fire. Yeah,
it's clearly broken now.
Yeah. It never again should be trusted. All right. Well. We have to get out of here because, as is a thing now, Mr. Wes has an upcoming episode of TechSnap. Woohoo! That's right. And so we can't just slack. We gotta be like a serious production here and make room.
It's new to us. We're working on it.
For the new TechSnap program, which is live on Tuesdays. In fact, all our shows are live. You can find their times at jupiterbroadcasting.com/calendar. You can leave us your feedback at linuxactionshow.reddit.com, a comment wherever you watch this, or go to jupiterbroadcasting.com/contact and send us in your feedback. We'd love to have you join us live next week at jblive.tv. Hang out in our virtual lug. There's always more, so catch the whole live experience, and we'll see you right back here next Tuesday.
Never installed GNU / Linux.
You know what's been weird, Wes, is I've been trying this bulletproof Linux at the same time that a lot of folks are blogging about switching from macOS to Linux.
Yeah.
And so it's been interesting to watch their...
What they reach out for.
Yeah. And I've been following BitCannon, which is, by the way, hashtag this guy. At first I was like, is this Wes? Because his hashtag on Twitter is Wes on Linux.
Wow.
Yeah. So BitCannon, a.k.a. Wes on Linux... He just posted another part two yesterday of switching from macOS to Linux, and it is a really good post. I debated reading it in the show. I just didn't want to rehash the same ground over and frickin' over again. But long story short, he settles on elementary OS because of how it looks, how it works, finds a bunch of cracks and rough edges as time goes on, ends up back on Arch. This is a macOS user. Ends up back on Arch and installing the Budgie desktop.
Heyo!
Which is pretty much exactly where I'm
at
right
now. Yes, it is.
Wow. Which is really interesting. They tried GNOME 3, and then he went to Budgie. I don't know. He went with the Arc theme and the Arc icons, too, which is my exact
that
setup.
That is, wow.
Anyways, it's fascinating post, bitcannon.net, if you want to read the rest of it.
Yeah, I like his blog. It's good.
Yeah, it has been really good to read this because as somebody who, like, is consistently thinking about this stuff. I love kind of reading, running through the kind of like path, you know, going down this, trying to read the same path mm-hmm. that these people followed. How did they end up here?
The context they were living in and how they're adapting.
Yeah. Why is he using Geary? Why is he using NeoVim? Why is he using Firefox? What was the thought process that led there? What is his opinion of files? All that stuff. Really good. Super good post. bitcannon.net if you want to read that. Almost made it into the show. JBTitles.com.
Only because if we put one more macOS X link, everyone will kill us.
I have to stop talking about it at some point, but I love it. It's like finally it's mm-hmm. happening. Death by Download, what's that a reference to? That's good. What's that a reference to?
The Android story, I believe.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Oh, yeah, right. Brick and the Thing. Yep. Beam Me Up, Popey, Software License to Kill. That's clever.
That is clever, yeah.
I like James Bond references. Black Phone Hits the Bricks. Plasma Heats Up Winter. These are good ones.
Mm-hmm. You guys are on fire.
Yeah. Needs More Wimpy. That's what
always.
The Red Pepper says. Needs More Wimpy. You hear that playing?
Wimpy's been typing furiously this evening.
Really? Well, good for you.
Black Phone Kill Switch.
Oh, Rakai, you just gotta embrace the default. That's my path to happiness.
Just use Breeze Dark. That's all you really need.
You got to. You have to, and then you have to be willing to just accept, like, I'm gonna be honest with you guys. There are aspects of Breeze Dark that don't hold up. Mm-hmm. Like, you have a full, so you take, like, the system settings window, and there's not, and you go to one of the settings that doesn't have a lot going on, and then you maximize that, you will see gradient bars in the dark theme.
I am
a picky son of a bitch, so I am letting some stuff slide, but only because with every iterative release, they have improved stuff. And I just feel like if I just hang tight,
yeah, it'll get better.
Yeah. Yeah. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't look worse than Breeze Light.
Do you have it on a, like, very large resolution screen? Because I'm on 1080p.
It's a 2K Asus screen, which I think is the perfect resolution for Linux. I think 2K, not 4K, not 1080p, but 2K is perfect for Linux. Everything looks great. Everything
that
scales
level
fine.
Of the scale is fine.
You can fit a ton of shit on your screen, but it's not where there's like the little issues. Like, where's that XPS? So this XPS 13 out of the box has high DPI support turned on. However, in the installer, what do you call the top bar in Unity? What do you call that? What do you call this top bar in Unity where all your menus hide?
Panel.
The global panel, the panel. So on the XPS 13, when you boot it up for the first time, the panel's doubled. You can, there's essentially, it looks like two panels, but what it really is the background graphic for the panel is just repeated twice. It's
we
shitty.
Fix that.
Yeah.
We fix that. System 76 fix that.
Right. I was going to say, is Ryan there?
And then do you see those lines at the bottom of the screen?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Also weird. only shows up under their implementation of high DPI.
Yeah, we totally fixed that too.
Yeah, that does bother me. That right there, those lines right there.
Now that I've seen it.
Only Wes can really see it probably right now. I don't think there's no way. But they're there. There's definitely little issues.
So Ryan, I'm going to say something and then you can carry on, okay? So Chris, fixes to those problems you've just described landed today.
Really?
Now, whoa.
Ryan, over to you.
Yeah, so we fixed those problems. Actually, David and our new kernel engineer worked on that, and Cassidy. That was a high DPI fix that we blogged. The fixes that we blogged about here recently, they bugged the hell out of us too. So we went ahead and did something about it, and those should be in the ISO in 1604.2.
Brilliant. Nice. Nice, very nice. Because
that's awesome.
It's just a little, it is getting down to some rough edges now, but they're rough edges where you're like, well, that doesn't look right.
Yeah.
Every once in a while, we go ahead and fix Dell's problems.